Donatella has picked on that too, the fact that we are now about actually sort of collective action dynamic. What we tend to take for granted, for example, the fact that protesters are usually pretty articulate. People, they are not animals or orangutans living on trees and smashing everything which comes their way. They are people with brains that are usually more cultivated than the average citizen, etc. This is something that is taken for granted by social analysis. We know that, but if you go outside our circle, it's not so obvious, it's not so accepted. So one thing, so in this sense, repeating, and as we've done in the third edition, some very basic ideas, also useful to remind ourselves that what is known to us is not necessarily known to people who do not focus in their activity or in their lives on the same problems that we address. And I think that's pretty much an important point of view. Another reason to stress the continuity, I would say, not to defend the Orthodox, but to stress the continuity in what has been done during these decades, is the fact that ultimately, when we were, it's important to, I think, to recognize the key problems that the field faced 50 years ago. Some of them have been mentioned, in particular the issue of deviance. But the other big, of course, the other big intellectual problem we had to face, or our teachers had to face, was how to deal with basically with Marxism. Not Marxism in general, because actually within Marx we find huge, very clear instances of analysis which are very resonant with what we have been done in this field, been doing in this field. All the historical writings of Marx are very clearly non-deterministic. But at the same time, it was more the point was more for this developing field was to challenge the over-deterministic, in that case, very orthodox interpretations of Marxism. So what does it mean? It means that when we have looked at, when we are in the development of our work, fundamentally we have work to show that collective action doesn't originate from the fact that there are structural problems in society. There was a very main target, and this account is also explains to some extent for the problem that Donatella was identifying, namely the fact that we have tended to forget about capitalism. We have for many years tended to forget about capitalism, maybe because we were ideologically affected, influenced by the general intellectual climate, but also because our first task was to, in the first place, was to show, okay, action it does not automatically originate from structural transformation. There has been, in my mind, there have always been, over time, attempts to recognize the importance of structural transformation. Even new social movement theory ultimately was rooted, several versions of it were rooted in the transformation from an industrialist to a post-industrialist society, in the emergence of new sectors of what was called new middle class, sectors of middle class with high intellectual capital, focused on the production of knowledge rather than on the production of material. And so there were elements there. But the general problem we were facing was the problem was grappling with the fact that the structure does not determine action. Another element which has been which came up, and another element which we need to consider is the fact that you cannot really size of conflict in America. This is another social science, and not only social movement research practice, social science in general is very much rooted, linked, connected to the present, it's fine. But at the same time, sometimes it's not so fine, I think. Because we tend, it brings us to spend, I would have to say, waste a lot of energy in building new theories, forgetting what are the basic tools that we have developed in the recent past. And in the third version of this, of the book, which is going to appear soon, reflects this attention. The first edition came out in the 1990s, when there were really very few attempts to synthesize, bring together different approaches in the theoretical synthesis. In many ways, the first edition was the first, one of the first attempts to, in particular, to bring together American and European approaches. And this was also just really in the press of Hooker remarked. And then, of course, we have become much more normal science, become a school science, more routinized in many ways over the years, and the field has grown immensely. We ourselves have also books like the Oxford Handbook summarizing the recent developments. So it's a kind of the idea of the third edition of this book is more to remind the readers of the basic tools that we may use, hopefully. These are our choice, these are the tools that we think are useful, but remind us that we are, that there is value in some very basic ideas. And I would like to point you in the first final part of my talk just to offer a few very sparse suggestions about two aspects which are fundamental. One is the transformation of structural interaction. And very, very basically, what we are seeing in the last few years, we have seen recurrent waves of massive growth. We have already seen them in 2011. We saw them at the turn of the century when following Seattle, etc. The question that these outbursts of protest, however, raise, and the challenges that we need to address, refer broadly speaking to at least, there are many more, of course, but at least to some two basic questions. What are the ideas that bring together all these events, all these actions? What are the ideas that enable us to say, okay, well, the protests in Athens are on against the crisis, are actually connected to the protests taking place in Milano or in Venice or somewhere in Cape Town, South Africa? What keeps them together? What enables us to people who are angry or worried or anxious for different specific reasons, what enables them to think of themselves as part of something which is larger, something which is broader? And that's where, and again, over the last decades, we have been struggling with this. Not just us as analysts, I think the activists much more in many ways, because we have been left without the main narrative of the dominant narrative, which, like it or not, the dominant shaped the 19th and 20th century. Class. The class conflict. Not, of course, it was not the only one, but nationalism. Even nationalism has changed. There are now, of course, many groups who claim to be nationalists, but if you look at it, it's quite a different kind of nationalism than the one, historical one. But certainly, very often, one of the big challenges in that one, in the book, we do not address systematically the current situation of main, but we refer to also to recent developments to identify some of the basic concepts. The one is the concept of framing, of course, or concepts like identity are concepts that draw our attention to the fact that this process of building links, creating connections between activities, campaigns is strong. And that's where I think forms of activism are somehow struggling. There is an immense amount of activity, but at the same time it's much more difficult to identify links. And there have been many attempts, some which have worked more or less, and which have also gained quite a broad attention. For example, in the book, the example we use in the book when you talk about precisely collective action frames and Right to the City is an idea which has circulated widely from the Fair to David Harvey. It's been picked as an idea that enables to assign a meaning to urban structures, precisely stressing the double dimension of urban structures, the quest for better services, the quest for access to specific provisions, to enjoy the full access to the resources offered by the city, the fight and the challenge against the privatization of those resources, or even of the public space, and with the quest for greater participation to democratic life. Also, there's been one of them. And there are signs for it. So one would question, but can we honestly say that the impact of such ideas is anything comparable to the one, no matter how vague, but they would be the one that the ideology of class conflict had in the past. Sadly, I would be very skeptical about this. So it's very much a thing that our book also reflects that what is kind of sad going on right now. Other example, and the other process which is a very important and essential is the process of organization. Now, the new social movements, one of the key elements of the social movements from the 70s is in particular the new social movements was the critique of bureaucracy, which of course extended to the Leninist organization. Paradoxically, the model of the even more recent theories of collective action is actually bought entirely into the Leninist model. 8 years ago, the late Alberto Lucci remarked that result mobilization theory is actually the economist version of Lenin in many ways. And he might have the point, but certainly one key characteristic of the different ways of protest we have faced has been a very difficult relation to formal organization. This has been already new social movement theory emphasized the role of informal networks, linking people who were embedded in more than everyday in their context of everyday life rather than in informal bureaucracy. And this has been massively amplified by the spread, of course, of the internet. And the idea that the internet could help would enable to coordinate and to do without organization. But I think this is deeply misleading. And I think one of the other issues that we currently have to face as analysts, first of all, we need to recognize the fact that this is certainly true, that actually not all collective action we see is closer to the model of the social movement we used to know. So we must not delude ourselves by saying that because there are people in the streets called upon by the internet, this will have the effect that organizations in the past, which, let's not forget, organizations were valuable because they secured continuity. For example, internet is very good at organizing one supporter. Mobilization is very good to keep the people who are already identified with the cause together, even though they live in very distant places. Pardon. Okay. Nice. Did you use it this time? I put the time, so that's why I need to close. But there is a fundamental distinction between what the organizations can provide and what links discourses created by the internet can provide. The internet certainly helps people to recognize that people with similar views to recognize it as part of the collectivity and to reinforce such views. Unfortunately, so far it has worked wonderfully for the extreme right. I'm not so sure it has worked for the rest, or certainly for the left or for the progressive, for reasons that I cannot tell you right now because my time has expired and I'm very disappointed. But perhaps this is one of the things that we can discuss with the energy left. Namely, we need to think as people who are interested, I suppose, in democracy, but even if as people who may not be interested in democracy at all, we need to come back and take seriously the issue of organization, and also including formal organization. So I think these two challenges, how we define ourselves, and second, how we coordinate our efforts, are a recurrent theme in the field, so there is a continuity. I don't know if it is orthodox or not, but certainly there is a continuity, and I think these are issues and challenges we need to readdress now from a different angle, in relation to different problems, but still very much central to our attempt to analyze, to understand the motivation better.